Batman may be the vengeance and the knight and all, but maybe more importantly, he's also the world's greatest detective who knows that sometimes you have to use logic and science in order to understand your enemies both inside and out. So, what disease does the Joker have? Well, let's get technical. To the Kyle computer! There have obviously been many iterations of the Clown Prince of Crime over the years, so if we want to be good detectives and answer this question, we need to come up with a consistent symptomology across all Jokers. Alfred, access the database.
Right away, Master Kyle.
The Joker is obviously homicidal. He is frequently overcome with uncontrollable bouts of laughter, and he has little regard for the well-being of other human beings. These are consistent psychological symptoms that must have some neurological underpinnings in his brain. Yeah! I was supposed to be gone. You. Now, most of the time on this program, we piece together pop culture and science to try to come to an acceptable conclusion for each. But in this particular case, Batman, being the great detective that he is, has already done a lot of the work for us. Yeah! Hey, you were In one of the entries in the fantastic Arkham series of video games, more specifically Arkham Knight, Batman is fighting to contain a transmissible pathogen that turns people into Jokers, a Joker disease, if you will. And in that game, he identifies it as a mutated form of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And he's not just making these words up either. This is a very real disease that is no laughing matter. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or CJD, is a degenerative brain disease similar to Alzheimer's. It is transmissible, incurable, and 100% fatal. The malady affects about 1 in a million people across the globe each year, and the Arkham games must have done their research because when you look into CJD symptoms, it starts to kind of fit with Joker pathology. The progression of the disease involves changes in personality, changes in walking or gait and movement, possible psychosis, hallucinations, and paranoia. It all starts to sound maybe plausible. And CJD can cause such changes to personality and mind because of what it does to the brain. To the Kyle Radiography Lab! That's not catchy. CJD is one of less than 10 diseases affecting humans that we term transmissible spongiform encephalopathies, or TSE. Transmissible because you can get them from infected tissue or bodily fluids, encephalopathy because it affects your brain, and spongiform because of what these diseases physically do to the brain. I'm about to show you some brain scans, and they're not graphic, but just in case you do not want to see any kind of medical anything, these are just MRI shots. I am warning you right now. Okay, so here are some brain scans. The brain on the left is from a normal patient, and the brain on the right has CJD. You can immediately tell that something is off, so let's look closer into the tissue itself. You can see normal tissue on the top in this scan now, and on the bottom, it looks like the brain tissue has holes in it, and it does. TSEs form holes in the brain, and holes in the brain, giving it a sponge-like appearance, spongiform, may start to explain Joker behavior. Oh, this flower probably smells lovely. Ah, I've been had! But CJD isn't caused by falling into a vat of chemicals or being Jared Leto. It's not caused by any fungus, parasite, virus, or bacteria. No, Joker disease might be caused by prions. The word prion is a portmanteau of protein and infection. And what makes prions so unique is that unlike bacteria, viruses, parasites, things that you could consider alive, prions are lifeless and almost indestructible. Proteins like this squiggly boy here are large molecules made out of amino acids according to the genetic instructions you hold in every single one of your cells. And proteins are involved in just about everything your body does. For example, this one is found on the outside surface of your cells. Now, we don't know exactly why it happens yet, but every so often a protein like this can misfold. You can see that its three-dimensional shape will change rather significantly, and this seems like it could be harmless, but the really scary thing is that just this simple molecular mistake can make this protein mimic a deadly infection. Just like how the Joker can master others with his madness, prions can cause other proteins to misfold in exactly the same way when they interact. We're not sure how every prion process happens, but basically something like this happens. A normal protein will come into contact with a prion and similarly misfold. These misfolded proteins will then tend to stick together as more and more normal proteins come into contact with them. Eventually, you have a big clump of prion protein that then somehow, we're not sure exactly what causes it to do this, it splits off into other infectious seeds that go on to make more and more prions. This exponentially increasing infection can literally lead to large clumps of prion protein called amyloids forming in and around a person's cells, like these brain cells here, which can cause cell damage and cell death. And if all that wasn't bad enough, these amyloids are extremely resistant to destruction by regular means, which makes prion diseases almost untreatable. To the Kyle computer! Going back to our brain scans from earlier, we now know how a prion disease like Creutzfeldt-Jakob could cause a spongiform encephalopathy. Amyloid buildups in the brain, which can cause cell death and damage, and because it's damaging the brain, it invariably causes changes to behavior and personality. If there were a mutated Joker prion that was blood transmissible, Batman might be exactly right in his diagnosis. However, I wonder if there isn't another prion disease that fits the cowl a little better. If we really wanted a real-world analog for what may be going on in Joker's mutated mind, maybe we should look at the prion disease known for his most famous symptom. In 1951, an Australian patrol officer named Arthur Carey published a report calling attention to an apparently new disease ravaging the Foray peoples of Papua New Guinea, which was controlled by Australia at the time. In his report, he called the disease Kuru, coming from the Foray word for to shake. In his report, he noticed the uncontrollable tremors, the shaking, the loss of mobility and control in those affected, but he also noted something very striking: uncontrollable bursts of laughter. Kuru is also known as the laughing disease. When scientists followed Carey and others' reports a few years later, they found that Kuru was spreading through the Foray people like an epidemic, and to find out why, they had to do a little detective work of their own. In 1957, American scientist Carlton Gajusik started doing his own experiments. He started doing experiments with chimps to see if Kuru could be spread through the ingestion of infected tissue, more specifically, brain tissue. Now, you may think, why were scientists concerned with the ingestion of infected tissue? Well, in this case, it was extremely important because the Foray people traditionally practice what's called funerary cannibalism. Upon their death, the people would eat the bodies and brains of their loved ones in the hopes of freeing their souls and their spirits from their bodies. Gajusik and his work had proved that eating brains was what was spreading Kuru through the Foray people and disproportionately to the young women and girls who were eating the brain tissue during these practices. And we also now think that this all started from a random case of CJD. Gajusik's work led the Australian administration to ban this practice in 1960, and afterwards, cases of Kuru started to drop, and 20 years later, Gajusik won a Nobel Prize in medicine. Bruce Wayne would be proud. The discovery of Kuru was one of the first big pieces of evidence that pointed towards prions as a new infectious agent. And you should know that since the 1960s, the Kuru situation in Papua New Guinea has gotten a lot better. Depending on the stats that you read, there hasn't been a related death since 2005. And recent studies actually suggest that the Papua people are actually evolving resistance to Kuru in real time. Nature. Given the possible changes in behavior, the transmissivity, the psychosis, the hallucinations, and the pathological laughter that a prion disease might cause, I think we have to say that Batman, at least in the Arkham Knight, might be exactly right. A prion disease like CJD, like Kuru, or a mutated form of Joker prion could produce Joker-like symptoms, a contracted Joker disease, if you will. Alfred? Take us home.
Back to the void it is, yeah.
So, what disease does the Joker really have? Well, based on video game and Batman lore and real science, I think we can say that Jokeritis is indeed a transmissible prion disease that causes enough damage and cell death to make specific and specifically disturbing changes to Joker's brain. Not everything about the Joker's diagnosis fits with real-world Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, but it's close enough that I think I'm comfortable with saying that Batman's capabilities as the world's greatest detective stands up to scrutiny, because science. Ha ha, nailed it. There's even more evidence that Joker disease, Jokeritis, as he calls it in the game, is definitely a TSE, or transmissible spongiform encephalopathy. In the game, it's an off-head comment, but he calls it mad clown disease, which is a play on mad cow disease, which is one of the more famous TSEs, which is just more evidence. But we should also note that when we talk about Joker disease, we're leaving out a lot of the terrible symptoms. Like I said, CJD is like Alzheimer's, so you're also dealing with terrible memory loss. The prognosis is less than 2 years that you have to live, and it's a terrible, terrible disease to go through. So obviously the Joker doesn't have any of those symptoms, but if we pick and choose a few of them, say it's a mutated form, then it might start to fit. But we must remember that these diseases are definitely terrible things that we need science to solve. Thank you so much for watching, Gary. If you like this video about Batman and the Joker, you might like some of our other Because Science Joker-related videos, like how deadly is the Joker's magic trick, and what poison is on Poison Ivy's lips? And you can also follow us here at these handles to give us suggestions for future episodes, and leave us your nerdiest comments, corrections, and questions everywhere that you can see this video. Thanks.